Hey everyone, in this video, let me explain you what is sickle cell anemia. So before that, so let's see, sickle cell anemia belongs to which categories here. So there is a broad terminology called hemoglobinopathies. So what is this hemoglobinopathies? So the pathology that is related to hemoglobin abnormalities are simply referred as hemoglobinopathies. Now the hemoglobinopathies can be divided into structural hemoglobinopathies, which include sickle cell anemia, sickle cell trait, HbSC disease, HbC disease, and all that kind of thing. So, and then the other category is thalassemia syndromes, which includes alpha thalassemias and beta thalassemias. And the third category is other hemoglobinopathies. It can be carboxy hemoglobin, methemoglobin, hereditary persistence of fetal hemoglobin, that kind of thing. Okay, now let's move on to see qualitative conditions, that is structural hemoglobinopathies. That's where sickle cell anemia falls into. Now what are the structural hemoglobinopathies? So in the structural hemoglobinopathies, so there won't be any change in the quantity of hemoglobin, but there can be alteration in the amino acid sequence in a globin part of hemoglobin molecule. Now, as you all know, hemoglobin has got two alpha chains and two beta chains. These are the globins. So these globins are coded by specific genes. And if there is any mutation in the gene coding for each of these globins, can lead to abnormality in a protein molecule, and overall that can lead to structural anomaly. So let's see what is sickle cell anemia now. Now the sickle cell anemia is a homozygous condition where two of the four globins, like two beta chains which are present in a hemoglobin molecule, that is a beta 1 and beta 2 chains, if both the beta chains are affected, so if both the genes that are coding for both the beta globins, that is beta 1 and beta 2, if they are mutated, that can give rise to a homozygote condition called sickle cell anemia. So usually the sickle cell anemia, it will be referred as HbSS for sickle. So that means both the beta globin are of sickle type. That's why it is a homozygote condition here. Now, what if only one beta globin is affected and other beta globin is a normal adult hemoglobin during that time? So you will write it as HbAS. Now here, Hb is a hemoglobin, A for normal adult hemoglobin beta chain, and S is a sickle beta chain. So this is what is the terminology here. So sickle cell anemia it's a homozygote condition where both the beta globins are, the gene that is coding for both the beta globins are mutated. Now what kind of mutation that we are going to see here? So in sickle cell anemia, so the kind of mutation that we are going to see is the codon GAG, which is coding for glutamic acid or glutamate, at the sixth position of beta globin. So the beta globin, I mean a sixth amino acid in a beta globin, it is coded by a codon GAG. GAG codes for glutamate. Now what happens in sickle cell anemia? So the mutation here is the base adenine, it will be replaced by thymine. Instead of adenine, so there will be thymine and other will be GTG now. So GAG, it will be converted into GTG. Adenine is replaced by thymine. That means purine is replaced by pyrimidine here. So that's a transversion type of mutation. Now the GTG is a codon for valine. Now the glutamate is coded by, is converted into valine. So the codon GAG, which is coding for glutamate, is now replaced by GTG, now which is coding for valine. So what happens? So the sixth position of beta globin, usually you see glutamate in normal adult hemoglobin beta chain. Now in sickle cell trait or sickle cell anemia, so you are going to see valine in glutamate position. So this is what happens. If only one beta globin is affected like this, we call that as HbAS, that is sickle cell trait. If both the beta globins, beta 1 and beta 2, both the beta globins are affected, it's an homozygote condition. And we call that condition as sickle cell anemia. Okay, now what is the issue here? So the number of amino acid in a beta globin is fine, it is normal, like no same number of amino acids are there. Only thing is there is a qualitative change here. So the qualitative change here is, it is the glutamate, which is normal, it should be present at the sixth position, is now replaced by valine. Now let's understand what is the issue with this. Now, as you all know from the classification of amino acids, glutamate is an acidic amino acid, it's a hydrophilic amino acid. So the glutamate is hydrophilic amino acid, that means it is soluble in water. Whereas, as you know, valine, which is one of the branched chain amino acid, it is hydrophobic. Valine is a hydrophobic amino acid. Now see the change. So the hydrophilic amino acid is now replaced by hydrophobic amino acid. So exactly opposite type of amino acid here. So the replacement here is a water soluble amino acid glutamate is now replaced by a water insoluble amino acid valine. So the beta position, sixth position beta globin in sickle cell trait or also in sickle cell anemia. So it is valine here, which is hydrophobic. So now see the issue here. So the problem is whenever hemoglobin is in oxy condition, whenever oxygen is bound to it, because the whether it is a sickle cell trait, sickle cell anemia, there is no problem with the binding of oxygen because oxygen is bound to the heme part of hemoglobin. It is not binding to the globin part. So what is the change that you are seeing here is in the globin, not necessarily not the heme. So the oxygen binding is not an issue. So the thing is, whenever hemoglobin is bound with oxygen, which we call it as oxyhemoglobin, during that condition, so there won't be any issues with the red blood cell shape and all that. So the problem comes only when the hemoglobin is in deoxy condition. So whenever oxygen is offloaded or unloaded in the peripheral tissue, so oxygen is coming from the lungs, binding to the hemoglobin molecule, and in the peripheral tissue, oxygen is unloading. So when the oxygen is unloaded, so hemoglobin gets into a T state or a tot state, which is a deoxy condition. So oxygen dissociation curve, I have a video, link for that video is available in the description below. So you can watch that video later, just in case if you are wondering what is the oxygen dissociation curve and how it behaves and all that. Anyway, so when the hemoglobin is in deoxy condition, so during this time what will happen? So there will be exposure of this valine at the sixth position of globin of hemoglobin molecule. So only this happens when hemoglobin is in deoxy state. So in the deoxy condition, hemoglobin, it exposes valine, amino acid valine residue. So that's an hydrophobic amino acid. And this hydrophobic amino acid is going to interact with the neighboring hemoglobin molecule, hydrophobic amino acids. And also note that in a red blood cell, where that's where hemoglobin is present, so there will be around 300 million hemoglobin molecules are found, and all of that hemoglobin is a soluble hemoglobin, especially when the hemoglobin is a normal adult hemoglobin, where there is no any change in the beta globin sixth position or anything. Okay, so when there is a change like this, where hydrophilic amino acid is replaced by hydrophobic amino acid, and the hydrophobic amino acid is now exposed during deoxy condition. So it's going to interact with the other hydrophobic amino acid in another hemoglobin present in the deoxy condition. Because of this, what happens? So this hydrophobic interaction brings all these hemoglobins, making a polymerization process. So there will be a hemoglobin polymerization happening in a deoxy condition in red blood cell. Because of this, what happens? So the normal hemoglobin, which is soluble in the cytoplasm, now becomes insoluble. So the solubility is affected here. So the all hemoglobin molecules, they polymerize. So there is a polymerization going on. And this is a long thread-like fiber can be made in the cytoplasm of red blood cell. This is an insoluble polymer which is made in the red blood cell. And that happens only in deoxy condition. So remember this. Deoxy state of hemoglobin leads to polymerization of hemoglobin molecule. So because of this, what happens? So the long thread-like thing, which is an insoluble fiber, which is present in the inside the red blood cells. So what happens because of this? So the red blood cells shape changes. So the normal biconcave red blood cell will change its shape to what is called as classic sickle shape. And that's why the name of the disease is sickle cell, because it's going to get that sickle shape. And anemia. Anemia is a lower hemoglobin content in the blood. Let's see why anemia occurs later. Now, in this deoxy condition, whenever hemoglobin goes into deoxy state, this is what happens. Polymerization of hemoglobin and change in the red blood cell into sickle shape, which is an insoluble type of hemoglobin now. So, like this kind of red blood cells, which are instead of biconcave shape, having that like good flammability and then going through the small little capillaries, and that particular feature for a red blood cell is not there now, because this is a rigid membrane containing like a rigid shape here, which is a sickle shape. Because of this, what happens? This type of cells will occlude small little capillaries. So there can be veno occlusion, capillary veno occlusion here in sickle cell anemia. So there will be a vascular occlusion, small occlusions can be seen. So the capillaries will be blocked by this abnormally shaped, the sickle shaped red blood cell. Because of this, what happens? So when the capillaries are occluded, so the blood flow, the normal blood flow that has to go on to the area which is supplied by that small little capillary, doesn't get sufficient oxygenated blood. Because of this, what happens? Eventually, the small little area, it will die, and that we refer it as a micro infarction. So vaso occlusion, so let me write it here, vaso occlusion happens because of sickle shape, and that vaso occlusion will lead to micro infarction. And this micro infarction, it can be seen anywhere in the body. So it can be seen in the spleen. So slowly spleen will be dying. So initially spleen will try to take out all these abnormal red blood cells. Spleen will be engorged and spleen size will increase initially. But as the spleen undergoes my repeated micro infarction, so it is not getting fresh blood for its tissues. So the spleen will, because of the continuous micro infarction will be healed by fibrosis. So the spleen size will decrease and eventually spleen becomes so small that it doesn't function anymore. So we call that as asplenia, functional asplenia. Sometimes it is referred as autosplenectomy. Autosplenectomy means spleen is there, it is so small that it doesn't function. It's kind of not having spleen. So this kind of issue we are going to see with polymerized red blood cell having that sickle shape, leading to vaso-occlusion, micro-infarction, and eventually giving rise to autosplenectomy. One of the functions of spleen is to take care of our body from encapsulated bacteria like Streptococcus pneumonia, Salmonella infections, pneumococci. These are like encapsulated bacteria, so there can be opportunistic infection in sickle cell anemia whenever they go into autosplenectomy. One of the complication of the sickle cell anemia eventually in these patients is osteomyelitis. So the osteomyelitis, which is an infection of the bone, and the common cause for this osteomyelitis is Salmonella. So the Salmonella, which is an encapsulated bacteria, so the Salmonella infection can be common in sickle cell anemia, eventually giving rise to osteomyelitis, which is the most common cause of osteomyelitis in sickle cell anemia as a Salmonella. And other encapsulated bacterial infection can be increased. So because of this, sickle cell anemia patients, they need to take vaccination and a regular prophylactic penicillin to avoid all these infections. Anyway, now what else microinfarction causes? Microinfarction can lead to leg ulcers, and repeated infections can go on. Now in this sickled red blood cell, it's an abnormal shaped red blood cell. So it will be continuously removed from the circulation, especially by the spleen. So there will be continuous destruction of the sickled red blood cell going on in a patient having sickle cell anemia. So that means more than normal number of red blood cells will be destroyed in this patient. So that means there will be continuous loss of hemoglobin molecule, because as the red blood cell is broken down, so the hemoglobin present in the red blood cell will be eventually converted into bilirubin, especially in the spleen and later in the liver also. So that means there is a continuous hemolysis going on here in the sickle cell anemia patient. So hemolysis, when there is a hemolysis, so that means there will be loss of hemoglobin. So that means there will be decrease in hemoglobin content in these patients. That's why it can put them into anemia condition. That is why the name of the disease is sickle cell anemia. Sickle cell, red blood cell is of sickle shape and decrease in hemoglobin. So that's why sickle cell anemia. So the and also hemoglobin, which is continuously converted into bilirubin. So hemoglobin is eventually converted into bilirubin. So there will be increase in bilirubin content in these patients. So that's why patients will have jaundice. So patients with sickle cell anemia can suffer from jaundice. That's because of increase in bilirubin levels. That is because hemoglobin will undergo continuous breakdown process. Now, the excess bilirubin can accumulate in the gallbladder and it can precipitate with the other minerals like calcium, phosphate and all that. So the calcium bilirubinate stones are common in sickle cell anemia, or for that matter, it is common in any hemolytic anemia. So calcium bilirubinate, calcium bilirubinate stones are common in sickle cell anemia patients. Now that's what we have seen. So like all these conditions can happen because of whenever hemoglobin going to deoxy state. Now what happens if the hemoglobin comes back into oxy state? Like suppose your say sickle cell which goes to the lungs or somehow, and when the oxygen is loaded on to the heme part of hemoglobin, this entire sickle cell will be converted back into its normal shape. So because there will be depolymerization of hemoglobin, so polymerized hemoglobin will undergo depolymerization under oxy condition. So this kind of polymerization and depolymerization can continuously go on in the red blood cell, and that's why it can affect the membrane integrity. Integrity of the membrane can be affected because of continuous polymerization and depolymerization process, and that can reduce the lifespan of red blood cells in sickle cell anemia patients. Normally is 120 days. That's a normal red blood cell lifespan in sickle cell under normal conditions. But in sickle cell anemia, this 120 days can be drastically reduced to 10 to 20 days. So the lifespan of RBCs in sickle cell anemias can be 10 to 20 days instead of 120 days. So these are some of the things that are related to sickle cell anemia. Now what is the treatment? So the treatment is to avoid getting into deoxy condition, like prevention of infection, not going into excessive exercise or abrupt changes in the temperature, anxiety, or whenever they we get into vigorous physical activity, something like that need to be prevented. And also whenever person go into sickle cell crisis, so the severe pain can be seen because of microinfarction. So the analgesia brain preventive medicines, and hydration is important to prevent viscosity in the cytoplasm, because polymerization can lead to increase in the viscosity. So hydration is important. And also how to prevent going into frequent sickling process. So another way to prevent is to use a drug called hydroxyurea. Hydroxyurea. So hydroxyurea is a drug where it increases gamma chains in red blood cells, so that thereby HbF content will be increased. So increase in the fetal hemoglobin content in the red blood cells, in newly synthesized red blood cells, where there is increase in HbF, and HbF has got higher affinity for oxygen molecule. That's why compared to HbA, so which you can watch my video in oxygen dissociation curve video. Link for that is given below in the description. So that when the HbF is increased in response to hydroxyurea, so because the hydroxyurea induces gamma chain gene, making alpha 2 gamma 2 chain increase in HbF, which has got higher affinity for oxygen, doesn't release oxygen quickly like adult hemoglobin, unlike adult hemoglobin, thereby HbF containing red blood cells do not polymerize quickly. That can prevent sickling process, thereby preventing vaso occlusion and microinfarction, and again all the signs that are related with that. This is something about sickle cell anemia. Especially I talked about homozygote condition, that is HbSS. In heterozygote condition, it is a kind of asymptomatic condition. Generally, patients do not exhibit significant clinical signs and symptoms because one of the beta chain is normal and other beta chain is abnormal. So that will generally, these patients, they don't go into sickling process. This is all about sickle cell anemia. See you in my next video.